All right, what else do we have? So are we adopting the policy that's in gray? Is that what you're recommending? And that's, the gray again is the district's recommendation?
At this time.
Okay. All right, and we're not approving, this is just a motion for the first reading of this?
That's correct.
Okay.
That's correct.
All right.
So is that all of your sections, Mike, or?
Yeah, one way or the other, we hit all six.
Okay.
So we're on to Eric, which now goes back to the 2000 section, correct?
Yes, I have one. It is 2623. I have it as page, hold on. It's packet page 36 of 97. It's a student assessment policy previously adopted by the board. The changes here are legal changes reflective of the changes of the titles of the state testing and the frequency in which the tests are given. Things that were struck through are no longer provisions in the state testing of our students, and things that were added either via bold or via the and the high yellow highlighting are the names of the new testing and the frequency in which they're given.
Okay.
Mm-hmm.
Any questions on that, or good? All right. What else, Eric?
That's my only policy right now.
Okay. So we're done?
Yep. And
good discussion.
We would ask for a approval of the first reading of the policy, and we'll bring back the changes that were indicated for the second.
I'll make a motion that we approve the first reading of policies as outlined in G1.
Okay, I have a motion by Trustee McClatcher, second by Trustee Hubler. Are there any questions?
I have a quick question. We are adding in the definitions of officer and agent, is that correct?
Mm-hmm. I have that
note. Yes.
Who supported that?
Don. Okay. Are there any other questions? All right, seeing none. All those in favor say aye.
Aye.
Anyone opposed? Carried unanimous.
Yes. Thank you.
We'll take.
Thank you.
5 minutes.
Six. Give us six, come on.
5 minutes, 7:51. Before we get into the curriculum instruction. We get started on our meeting. We're going to bring it back to order at 7:54. Next on our agenda, we have our curriculum instruction office. So, Eric?
Okay, thank you.
Here they come.
Now, I'd just like to go over some results, some comprehensive overall results of student testing from last spring. As a quick update, that's actually the board policy we just changed. Another year of some changes, significant changes at the high school level, and some changes in the M-STEP. So again, this is the second year of the M-STEP for our students in grades 3 through 8, and then grade 11. And the change for grades 3 through 8 is that they changed the ELA assessment, and there's not as much scored writing on it as there was in the first year of the test, 2015. The state said that that's one of the reasons that scores came out even later last year, is that it took a very long time for them to score. I think it's important to know, and I don't want to derail the conversation, but the goal of the intent of the state is eventually to take these assessments and make them a major component of student growth measures that would be tied to teachers for their evaluation. So it is the state's intent to release these scores they claim in time in the future for evaluations to be school year end for teachers. And so they are under some pressure, and there's some competition between departments there to release these scores as soon as they can. They did do better this year at meeting their own deadline. So it was September. Last year was Christmas. It was the day before Christmas break, actually. So it's a significant improvement, but there are still some real challenges to releasing these scores in time to be counted for teacher evaluations at the end of the year. especially since students are still testing well into the end of May. So to be determined on that, but that's also part of the legislation, that 2 years from now, that is supposed to be the case for the teachers. Back on the topic of this, the other changes for this year are in 11th grade. Last year only, the students took M-Step in all four subject areas. When I say four subject areas, I'm referring to math, ELA, social studies, and science. And then they also took the ACT last year, which also covers math and ELA and science last year. The Principals Association was quite frustrated with this, so was Curriculum Association was too, because students were sort of double testing in different areas, and the high school test 2015 was extremely long. It took students a very, very long time to complete. So what they did this year is the students did not M-Step test in 11th grade in the areas of math, reading, or writing. They didn't do that. So they just took the score, they just took that in part of their SAT test. So again, they had one math test comes from SAT, one ELA test comes from SAT, one science test comes from M-Step, and one social studies test which comes from M-Step. The biggest change for high school though was that this was the first year of SAT. So they did transition away from ACT, which was a test given for many, many years at our high schools as a mandatory test, and now in this year, the first year is SAT. So again, although M-Step was round two for many students, there are still some changes to that test, and then the biggest change is moved to SAT. I will say that you'll see, and I'll try to point this out as we go, SAT and ACT are scored very differently. SAT is only an ELA and a math test. It does not specifically have science objectives, although science is tested through some of the writing that they, or some of the reading that they have to do on the test, but not specifically science objectives. So, so third grade is the first year students take these tests, and this is the, and you'll see some similarities in the setup of this, I hope. And as a the district, throughout this whole presentation, I believe will always represent the dark blue bar. The red bar is the county results. That would be all the schools in the Macomb ISD. And then the green would be the state results, state average. So you can see this is our performance in math. And it's, again, I think I mentioned this before, objective and relative performance are two very different discussions to be had by anyone when you're talking about test score results. So, of course, it's important to look at how you performed relative to others, but also just what was your score? How did the students do overall in your district? And I think those are two very different conversations. So, for example, just on this one, it's easy to see that although we are above the state and county by similar amounts in third, fourth, and fifth, we are actually doing better relatively in fifth grade, although the score overall is lower. So why? That's a lot of pouring into data to see why, but you can see the performance of people across the state and the county did not do well, relatively as well in fifth grade as they did in third and fourth grade, but we did a little bit better again, but not as well as in our earlier grades. So it's kind of two parallel conversations you have to have, and this is still just this is sort of the view from the district level. But again, good that they maintain those.
Go ahead.
Beating the state county.
Could that be due to curriculum changes?
It can be due to a lot of things. One of the things that is, through discussions, some initial discussions that we've had, again, this is about 3 weeks old, is that there are test differences. The test writers at each grade are not necessarily the same test writer. So again, this is M-Step. This is a Michigan test only. This is not a nationally normed or standardized test. They do test these questions out. So the kids did take some extra questions this year that quote unquote weren't scored, and they intend to use those in the future. They don't exactly say how they have to perform in order for them to be included or not. But I think one of the arguments is that it could be that there was change in curriculum, although not that I'm aware of specifically for fifth grade, but it was obviously a more challenging test to students across the state of Michigan.
What I didn't understand when I got the results back from my daughter was that the margin for proficient or highly proficient I think the highly proficient, right?
Highly, yeah.
It's only, I think it's...
Advanced proficient.
Right, it's small, I mean, it's very small, I think it's only, I don't even know, it's very small.
So I don't...
I guess, where are we, if you were to use the M-Step, like, where are, I forgot what the numbers are.
So, right, so I think, on the student reports that all the parents just got, they just got them very recently, they all went home to parents, and we sent a letter home to parents on interpreting them, there's a couple very confusing things about them. Number one, you get this bar graph, I wish I don't have one in front of us, sorry, but you're referring specifically to it. Advanced is the top score you can get, and then proficient, and then partially proficient, and then not proficient. The range of the bands is not consistent from test to test. So the advanced band is a broader or more narrow set of scores based on the particular test. And the answer to why that's the case has to do with what the state's trying to norm the performance of the test, and they're trying to see how many people ended up in each band. So they are arbitrarily changing the size of those bands year to year based on the relative performance of the kid. So again, if the test was quote unquote easier, and I don't, you know, I'm certainly not a statistician, but if it was easier, then that advanced band would be smaller in that particular year. If the test was harder, then that advanced band would be larger and all the rest would be adjusted.
So if we were to use the state's proficient guide, where would we be in fifth grade?
Okay, so this by the state definition, this would be the students in category advanced and proficient only. It does not include any of the students that are minimally proficient or partially proficient, excuse me, or not proficient.
Okay.
So this does combine them together. It's not linear.
38.3%.
Correct. So then, and I'll stop and move on, but when we, the next thing, and this is associated with those AMOs that I was talking about before, the actual mark of success according to the state of Michigan comes with our report card, comes with our school and district report card, which again is supposed to be timely based on these results, largely based on these results, plus graduation rates, dropout rates, other things like that, teacher evaluations. That is also late. They use a different metric for how many kids they count for proficiency in that. So they change how many kids are proficient when they report that out. So when that comes out, should have been by now, but when it comes out, I'd be happy to bring that. And you will see, if you looked at fifth grade math M-Step on that, which is our official school district report card, it will not be 38.3%. It will be a different proficiency amount because they count a different set of students for that. They do not know, the explanation of that is not clear at all, but they do not take just the advanced band and the proficient band, and just like I'm showing here. This is how the state reports the scores as raw scores, not how we're evaluated.
Eric, as a parent, I find that really frustrating. As a board member, I find that extremely frustrating. As in your position, does this not make you want to pull your hair out?
Well, it is political, but it's also that there's different offices doing these things.
Right. So seriously,
that there's different agencies at the state working on these things separately.
If I were to look at this, it's just John Q. Public, and I pulled it up on the My Data website, mm-hmm. or if it was even on the district website, and I looked at this and I see percent proficient on the left, and it goes up to 50. My first question is, Then I go over here and look at fifth grade math and go 38.3 mm-hmm. district. I'm looking at that and saying, that's how good we did as a district mm-hmm. in fifth grade math. So this is really like a partial story.
Correct.
And it's unfair. It's unfair
the story we have so far.
Yeah.
It is the story we have so far, not the full story.
I actually thought my child's scores were spot on with where his intelligence lies and how well he does just based on his homework. I thought the test was pretty accurate.
Mm-hmm. It's the cut score that the state determines to be proficient between our report card and the raw mm-hmm. school scores that change. So it wouldn't, if a student's advanced, they're still going to be advanced. Okay,
right,
let me
right.
put it to you that way. But what they do is they determine what's proficient at a different line than those bands on the raw scores are showing.
There is so much writing on this stuff. It's amazing to me that we can have the state keep making the kind of changes, the frequency of changes, and then aggregating everything together. It is, feels unconscionable.
And the last thing that was different this year is it was an adaptive test, which is theoretically a very good idea because it saves time, but the kids did get different questions. The kids did receive different questions based on how they were performing on the test. Math, again, you see that we do not have, you see up and down here really, but you still see we are within 0.1 of the state and above county sixth grade, above state and county in seventh grade, and basically about even, it's all state, county, and us are even at the eighth grade level for this. Oh, and I can come, go backwards or forwards, however, just to bring up. Now ELA, and again, math and ELA are the only tests that kids take every year. Yeah, ELA, state and county, grades 3, 4, and 5. If you recall, the math test apparently was more difficult for fifth graders and the scores were relatively lower, although we still had outperformance of those two groups. Not the case with ELA. It was apparently an easier test, or something was different with the ELA test because the performance of all three groups was higher for fifth grade ELA. So it's not necessarily just all one grade versus another, it's the test within the grade too. Middle school ELA, again, above state and county in sixth grade, seventh grade, and eighth grade for middle school ELA. Science, and this is the confounding one. This is the one that is, it really tells the story of objective performance versus relative performance, that it is given only twice in the 3 through 8 grade band. The expectation of this test is that it covers K through 4th grade material on the first test and then 5th grade through 7th grade material on the second test. This is still based on the old standards, obviously, not part of the discussion that we had a month or two ago about changing science standards. However, we, relatively speaking, we actually are doing the best in science of any of the areas. Objectively speaking, in fourth grade, no one's doing very well. So this is a real, this is very, again, we are, the entire state, the entire nation really, has very, has scores that are not good in science, and there's a million reasons or stories beyond that. We are doing relatively better, and have been doing actually better than the state and county. Obviously room to grow, but we, that's fourth grade. Seventh grade, now they have science every day, and it's consistent every day in a block of time. It's more of a challenge at the elementary. But we have I believe that's a very good job in seventh grade of those students in relative performance. Social studies, a little bit of a different story. And again, it's very difficult to trend this data because we do not have consistent years. They changed the two grades that are taking social studies and science this year. But competitive, but not outperforming at the eighth grade level. Very close to the county, but in most other areas at the K through 8 level, we're outperforming county and state. So there's some look-ins on that one that need to be done. Again, it's not drastic, but relative to the same student, some social studies looking to be done in basically the middle school level, some in the elementary as well, but mostly the middle school level in this is my opinion. It needs to be started into. I don't know exactly. What they will release, hopefully, they've said, is a report basically on how the kids did on standards. So these are all the standards that were tested, and then this is how they did on each standard. So you get an idea of, if you see that lots of kids did well on these 10 standards, then those are things that you're teaching to an appropriate level or don't need to be reinforced, or you can continue along the same way with those 10. But if you see 5 or 6, 10 standards that students did not do well on, because these are of course average scores, then that's where you have to highlight teaching as you know, for those students. So those are the ones that students didn't absorb or for whatever reason were very difficult for the students or were harder for them to understand. So that report is forthcoming, they claim, but that's not been made available yet. We don't have an item analysis of the test. Okay, now we're going to make a total jump to high school, because again, the kids do not test again until 11th grade, and we're looking at a totally different test. So we're not talking about M-Step anymore. We're talking about math. This is one that I'll talk a little bit more about at the end, but you do not see a percentage proficient anymore. This is a raw score. SAT is scored out of 800 for each subarea. And you can see that as a district, we outperform the state and the county. Pleased with that. Lance Creuse North did exceptionally well in math. It's actually interesting, if you look at the county high schools, most high schools did better in ELA than they did in math. I don't know, I mean, the English test was, I don't know if it was easier or not easier, they did better in English than they did in math. Even schools that did very well on the test or schools that didn't do well on the test. North actually has a slightly higher math score than their ELA score, so very good. High school has some challenges in math here. This was noticed last year at high school for a totally different test that they took, the ACT. And we'll talk about, we have many things going on with that. Mr. Chapsky and I, and teachers as well, have been working on this for the last 3 weeks, actually before that, but really heavily the last 3 weeks. But as it, what is the district above the state and county? In ELA, we see both of our, the district is above the county and within a point of the state, and both high schools, comprehensive high schools, are above state and county in ELA, so that's good. And good performance, of relative performance in ELA for the SAT test for both high schools.
Again, ELA is out of 800 again?
That's correct, okay. And it's a combination of writing and reading. This is where they supposedly get science too. Some of the reading passages they do are science reading passages, but again, there's no specific science or social studies standards tested on the SAT. Composite score is basically just putting them together, and this is what colleges want to know. Colleges may want to know the subscore of the student as far as their math or their ELA, but mostly they just want to know this score. This is new for our students, obviously, because they're used to reporting ACT scores to kids, to schools, which is out of 36 points. Most colleges in Michigan are adapting to this fine, and our students are not going to have to also take an ACT test, although some of them are choosing to do so. Michigan has been an ACT state for a really long period of time, so now suddenly the schools are going to get all SAT scores from kids. There are some crosswalks, which ways to compare ACT and SAT scores, which may or may not be totally reliable. There's a lot of discussion about that, whether you can say a 20 on the ACT equals this on the SAT. SAT says yes, you can do it, and ACT says no, you can't. So I'm not sure how much that'll be used, but again, I have not heard that our students are having to retest ACT just to apply to colleges for this.
Can we talk about this a little bit?
Sure.
I did some research just because I really was not real familiar with SAT, mm-hmm. since it's we always used ACT. The highest score for SAT is 1600.
That is correct.
And the lowest score is 400. So it's between a 400 and a 600 range, 1600 range. Correct? Am I correct so far?
Yes.
I went back and saw some statistics. Out of the 1,600, the top 25% students rank about 1,200. Mm-hmm. Average students are 1,000. Mm-hmm. And the lowest 25% was 840 and below, of course. So I went back and I looked at some of the colleges and what they look, and they're really all over the board.
They're adept to this, yes.
U of M, 1430 is their average SAT. Mm-hmm. Michigan State, their average is 1180. Mm-hmm. And we've got some work to do.
Well, and again, I think when we look back at SACT, there was probably similar results for that as well. I mean, I don't know what the ACT cut scores were for Michigan and Michigan State. I'm sure they changed. I know Michigan was usually 30 to 32, and the state was something around, you know, 25 to 28 usually. Again, and I wish I could correlate these so you'd have a more of a view into the future or into the past on this, so you could see if this is relatively as good as in the past. So this again speaks to the middle score of the students, the average, the mean score of the students. So if the mean and the median line up, which they don't always line up, you would expect that, you know, about half of the kids did better than that, and about half of the kids did worse.
Right, but when I pulled all the county rankings of high schools, one of our high schools was at the top of the list, five out of the county, six maybe, somewhere in that area. And then, it seems to me when you look at different districts, when you look at Utica schools and how their high schools are all clustered together, when you look at different districts where they may have two different high schools, and Utica schools by all means have buildings that would be considered in very different, I don't wanna, socioeconomic, Ford and Stevenson, right, much different than students going to Eisenhower, yet all of their scores are within a close range of each other.
Between the schools, you mean?
Yes. And so I'm wondering where our disconnect is.
So, I have some response to that. I mean, not a total story. Math was the biggest gap between them. I would say the gap was smaller and similar in ELA, and when we see science and social studies, you'll see that as well, that the gap was smaller and similar in science, social studies, and SAT between our two high schools, much bigger in math, and that equated for a larger difference in the overall score. So,
but I think even when you look at a district like the one that I teach in, two very, very different populations, Marine City and St. Clair are two very different populations. They were within a point of each other at 1040. And so there, something is working as far as everyone's on the same page, everyone's working towards the same goal throughout the district. We have common growth assessments. We have all those things in place, and they've been in place since 2011 when the state mandated we have them. So there's some disconnect here that we need to take care of as a curriculum department. Because, so who put goals and strategies in place? Did the buildings do it separately?
I think a difference is you mentioned the socioeconomics being more flat in other places or different in other places. And although speaking of socioeconomics is not an attempt to, I don't know how else to say it. It's not the bottom line excuse as to why scores are different, and it shouldn't be.
It can't be.
However, it is important to know that on a line graph of socioeconomics and test performance over the past several years in Michigan, it's a very close relationship. And again, just for information, the number of students, percentage of students at high school that are economically disadvantaged as determined by the state is 10% higher than it is at high school north. I mean, for this group of testers, it's between 8 and 11% basically from year to year. So, but it was about 10% for this. And that is not a complete story. It is not. I'm not saying that it is, but it is part of the story. I believe that can account for some of the differences in the other tests. If you look at the other graphs, the other three are ELA, social studies, and science, you see a small difference between them, and I believe that can account for it, and the differences in math are beyond that, and those are things that are being addressed, and I would speak to those at the end, because there's some very active work in that area, and building is very eager to address these issues, very eager.
They're not new issues.
They are.
The disparities.
They're growing issues, though.
Well, they've only increased in disparities. So tell me what it is that we're doing to address this. because like I said, it's not a new issue. The disparity has been, the entire time I've been on the board, so the last 4 years, the disparity's definitely been there between the two buildings, and it's growing. And what are we doing specifically to address it?
Again, it's not growing in the other areas, it was growing in math.
No, let's just speak to math right now. So math is one curriculum area.
Correct.
What have we been doing over the last 4 years to address this disparity?
So there's been several things that have been tried in math, some of them being classes to support at-risk learners in math as supplementary courses for the students, so they're taking two different courses in math, a core class and a supplementary class, a support class, you might call it. There has been some different things done with juniors to prepare them for testing. There has been done, there's a, been a realignment of what Algebra 2 class students get in the 11th grade. We offer a two-year Algebra 2 course that covers part of the content in the first year, and then we also offer a full-year course. We've looked at how students are placed into that class because that's the class that they take right before they take the test. It should be the most fresh in their mind and pertinent information. We have looked at rearranging orders of classes and giving more support to students that come in. I will say that, and it's not reflective here, the scores in math, and again, is not the complete story. Coming from 8th grade into 9th grade at the south end of the district are not as good as they are coming from 8th grade to 9th grade at the north end of the district. Now what we're doing now is a couple of things. Number one, we're looking at, we have this TRIG grant, which has been in place for a couple of years, which is intended for technology readiness for state testing, and we have been using that for various hardware and software applications. One thing we're looking at for high school, and Steve and I have been looking at this for the last, for a while, is introducing something called Carnegie Math. It is supported by the ISD. It's an intensive math support program for teachers. It helps teachers learn the exact level of each student, gives students problems, and supports them with exactly what their issues are. I think that we are struggling with differentiation between a lot of levels of students in similar classes, so that there are some very high level students and some very struggling students in the same classes, and this helps with that. Another thing we're doing is we have just gotten signed on to a professional development that has shown very good gains in math called Math Talks, and it is a way for students to self-reflect on their math learning and what they understand in math. And what it does is it shows the teacher if the kids understand it or not. So I believe one of the main things we need to do in math is how do the teachers know, besides just at the end of a unit test or on an exam that they give at a unit, if the kids are getting it or not. And these, both of these measures give teachers much more current and information, more accurate information more frequently as to whether the student's understanding or not. And it allows the teachers to know whether they need to go back, make some adjustment, reteach something before they just, you know, give the student a test after 4 weeks and well, they got it or they didn't get it. So it's that's those are the two of the main things we're doing right now.
So these are all things that you have in place, right? Classes for at-risk learners with the support class being an extra class now. You're having extra support for juniors that are having difficulty getting it. A realignment of Algebra 2 to make it a two-year course. Placement, you're reviewing the placement for the Algebra 2 students to see who's appropriate and who's not. You're rearranging the classes for increased what again?
So this to try to get students more appropriately placed in the classes, there's not as much difference between
some of the
students.
Okay. And then now we're going to go to Carnegie Math, which is a support for a math support for teachers, and we're going to add some PD with the math talks.
Correct.
Okay. Again, for the last 4 years, this disparity has increased. So that leads me to believe that what you have in place currently isn't helping, right?
I don't, you know, and I can't.
Unless you really think that the disparity would just, I mean, absolutely turn into a balloon if you didn't have these things in place, right?
Well, I don't have the.
How are you evaluating these is what I want to know. Because if you're evaluating them and finding them to be ineffective, then why aren't we going in a different direction?
Well, we
I understand you're going in a different
Correct.
Direction now,
Correct.
But this disparity has ballooned now. I mean, it's a massive aneurysm.
This is a different test.
Yeah, I don't have this, unfortunately.
I'm talking about the disparity. I'm not talking about the test specifically. No matter what test you have, if you have kids that have the solid knowledge base, their test scores should be similar. There's no question about that. So just give me a minute to finish what I'm asking here. So how do we have any idea? We have this TRIG grant where we're gonna do Carnegie Math, which is a support for teachers, and we have the professional development of the math talks. But we have math coaches in place too. So if your math coaches are doing something that works at one school, why aren't they doing the same thing that works at the other school? Why do we have a disparity? There is no reason in a district where, I know before I came onto the board, the big initiative was make everything the same across the district. And we don't have everything the same across the district because we don't have the same scores. And you can talk about socioeconomic until you're blue in the face, but I cry BS on that one. Because I've been in this district and I know these kids in the south end of this district, and I'm telling you, there might be some disparity, but even in the disparity, there's some seriously brilliant kids.
There definitely are. There definitely are.
So to say that it's all about disparity is ridiculous.
I didn't hear him say that it was that.
No, he said it's not the whole answer, but he considers it part
right,
of the answer.
Right, so he didn't say it was.
I don't think it's any part of the answer. Because we have disparity in the north end.
It's part of the answer. In other districts, it's not. If you compare free and reduced at Stevenson or Utica to Eisenhower, and yet they're scoring the same, that's about curriculum. That's not about disparity.
I hear on that, but I was going to suggest that we entertain the question of...
What are we doing about it?
That we entertain the question of... We are all different districts pulling from different places, right? And I agree. You know what? Socioeconomic status should not be
an excuse
for not doing your best and doing well in school with all the supports we have in place for you. But I would suggest we entertain the idea that we look at where some of our students are coming from. And what did they come into this district with?
So let me give you
a highest scoring buildings?
I'm sorry, I would like
Lakeshore or Lakeview. So that's just BS.
I would like
Let Don go and then Pam and then we'll go back.
And then actually Sharon really wasn't done.
Well, Sharon wasn't done?
Sharon wasn't done because she got interrupted again, but that's good.
Go ahead.
Jeff recognizes that Sharon wasn't done.
Oh, recently the state conducted an advocacy study. And they did find the significant factors are English language learners and poverty. That's a fact. I mean, that is a study that directly relates student performance and what's offered. So to say that it is not to be considered or not a factor would be contrary to data and everything else that comes into the classroom. So we can say to ignore it, but the facts are that it does have significant
impact. Then how do other
impact.
Districts do it? Tell
well,
me.
Okay, so what you look at are, well, so do we ignore it? Do we pretend it isn't a matter? No, I don't think that's realistic. What you have to do is look across the board at all the things, all the factors, and try to develop a plan. Now, we have had significant test scores difference between North and South, or North and Central for a significant period of time, especially in math, and that's been the priority, or the significant one. So I appreciate the fact that they're trying different methods, different things, and looking at our student body. So as a board member, I think that we need to look at all the factors and look at all the opportunities to address it.
Okay.
Well, last year, the high school students took the MSTEP, and right?
That's correct.
And if you remember, high school North was much lower on test scores than high school.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that was an anomaly. Yeah.
That was.
It was significant.
It was a significant difference, and there were a lot of reasons why that happened. We've had that discussion. So, my question though is, all students, all 11th graders took SAT, correct?
Correct.
Did that include special ed students?
Yes.
So it is quite possible that we have a very high special ed population compared to some of the other other districts, if we start comparing ourselves to other districts, and that could be a variable as well.
Right.
I mean, I do think that there's a lot of variables that play into all of these numbers, but, and that could be a difference between high school and high school north. I mean, I don't, I, on the hand, don't know.